So guys, today we are going to discuss about one of the important function of muscle, which is tension. So this muscle has a unique ability to develop tension and to exert force on a bone in order to move the bony lever. Fine. So this tension, the total tension in the muscle, is identified as a vector quantity which has four things: a magnitude, two point of application, distal and proximal, an action line, and direction of pull. Okay, so there are two types of tension in a muscle. Okay, active tension and passive tension. This is important because the total tension which a muscle can produce is a sum of passive tension and active tension. Now, what is this passive tension? Passive tension is a tension developed in a parallel elastic component of muscle. So this parallel elastic component of muscle consists connective tissues of the muscle like endomysium, perimysium, epimysium, and the elastic protein which is statin, and your vessels. Fine. So what is this active tension again? So this active tension is a tension developed in a contractile elements of the muscle. So this contractile elements are your sarcomere, which consists myofilaments required for contraction and relaxation. So the amount of active tension which a muscle can generate depends upon two factors. One is neural factor and second one is mechanical properties of muscle. So what are these neural factors? The size of motor unit, the number of motor unit, and the frequency of motor units firing. So that is the neural factor. Coming to the second factor, which is your mechanical properties of muscle. So these mechanical properties of muscles are the relationship between length and tension. Again, this is isometric relationship. Then coming to the force velocity relationship, which is required for your dynamic contractions like eccentric contraction and concentric contraction. So now we are going to discuss about the isometric length tension relationship, which is also called as skeletal muscle sarcomere length tension relationship, only for isometric contraction. So it goes like a graph, x and y axis. X axis has tension and y axis has length. Okay, now we will see active tension curve. It goes like that and comes down. Okay, fine. Then the passive tension curve goes like that. So this is active tension, this is passive tension. So this active tension is for contractile elements and passive tension for non-contractile elements. Fine. So let's consider three points here. Okay, 1, 2 and the third point. So in this first point, what it says is that as the length increases, the tension generating capacity, the active tension generating capacity of the muscle decreases. In that scenario, if you consider sarcomere, it would look like this. Okay. See, length here sarcomere with the, if you consider this line, few number of very few number of cross bridges formation. So in this length, what is the amount of tension a muscle can produce? In this length, it is very less because of the presence of number of cross bridges. It's very less. Fine. So coming to the second point, where there is less length, okay, and less tension. Okay, in that scenario, how a sarcomere would look? It will look like this. Okay, again, in this scenario, tension is less. okay, that is because of the interdigitation of your myofilaments, actin and myosin. As you can see, this is your actin and this is your myosin. Myosin, actin. So you may think there are more number of cross bridges formed. Actually, there are very less number of cross bridges formed, and the possibility of tension production is less due to the interdigitation. This interdigitation will not allow the filaments to slide further. That's why there are reduced tension. Fine. So that is about the second point. Coming to the third point, which we call it as optimum length. Okay, this region is called as optimum length. Optimal length. Okay, in that scenario, let's see how sarcomere would look. Again, this is purely for isometric contraction. Don't get confused with the dynamic contractions like eccentric and concentric contractions. Here, if you see, there are more amount of cross bridges formed. Okay, so if there are more amount of cross bridges formed, there are more energy, there are more acetylcholines. Okay, that's why in that optimal length you can see more amount of tension. That muscle can produce more amount of tension in optimal length. Okay, so that's about active tension. Now, what this passive tension tells you? So this passive tension tells you that as the length increases, the passive tension generating capacity of the muscle increases. Fine. So that is about it. Now we need to calculate the total amount of tension, how it goes. Total tension is equal to active tension plus passive tension. Now you need to add active tension with passive tension in order to get total tension. So we will add active tension with passive tension. So we need to add this. So this thing we need to put it here. Okay, that would look like that. Fine. Okay, when we add all these points, we get total tension. It goes like that. Okay, this is your total tension. Fine. So what this total tension tells you, okay, as the muscle length increases, the total tension producing capacity of the muscle also increases. This is very important when you train a muscle or muscle setting program. Okay, you need to first concentrate on the muscle length. If the muscle length is more, the tension producing capacity of that particular muscle will increase. So the performance of the individual will increase. So this curve tells you about the importance of length and tension. Okay, if you have more length, there will be more tension. Fine. So that was about the isometric contraction. Now what about the dynamic contractions like eccentric contraction and concentric contraction? So in order to know the amount of tension which a dynamic contraction can produce, we need to combine the length tension relationship of isometric contraction with the force velocity relationship. Let's see the force velocity relationship. So the curve would look like that. Fine. So this is shortening contraction, which is your concentric contraction, and this is your lengthening contraction, which is your eccentric contraction. Okay, I can say eccentric contraction, can say concentric contraction. Fine, we need to have force, we need to have velocity. Velocity of shortening, velocity of lengthening. So what this force velocity relationship states? It states that the force generated is the function of the velocity of the muscle contraction. So when it is a concentric contraction, what happens is that the speed of contraction is inversely proportional to the tension, muscle tension in concentric contraction. Fine, whenever the speed increases, tension decreases. Okay, if you do it fast, tension decreases. Okay, if you do it slowly, the tension increases. That's what it says for a concentric contraction. So what about for eccentric contraction? Eccentric contraction, it says that as the lengthening contraction increases, okay, the tension will also increase and further it will plateau. Okay, it will saturate like that. So the lengthening contraction increases, the tension also increases, and it becomes flat. Okay, so here speed of contraction is proportional to the tension, muscle tension. Fine, so that's about eccentric contraction. So if you take it like bicep, like that, okay, the tension produced is less. If you take it little fast, tension produced is more, and further when you reach at the end, it will plateau. Okay, so that's about eccentric contraction. So what happens in isometric contraction? In isometric contraction, the velocity of shortening is equal to zero because the external force is equal to the internal forces. Okay, that's why it is called as isometric contraction. And the tension produced is greater than the concentric contraction. Tension is greater than the concentric contraction. Fine, that is about the force velocity relationship to all the type of contractions. So this relationship between force and velocity also states that at maximum velocity of shortening, no force is produced. So at maximum velocity of shortening, no force is produced. So if velocity decreases, what happens to force? Force will increase. So that is about force velocity relationship. So now if we consider force velocity relationship and isometric length tension relationship, we can determine one thing: which type of contraction can produce more amount of tension considering all the factors. Fine, so it is eccentric contraction. Eccentric contraction can produce more amount of tension than isometric contraction. Isometric contraction can produce more amount of tension than the concentric contraction. Why? Because of the availability of the length. So finally, this discussion tells you that in order to obtain greater amount of tension, first of all, you need to have a lengthier muscle fiber. Then the velocity differs based on the type of contraction. If you need higher tension in concentric contraction, the velocity should be lower. If you need higher tension in eccentric contraction, the velocity should be more or higher. If it is in isometric contraction, the velocity should be zero or it should be equal to the external force. Fine. So that's about the skeletal muscle sarcomere length tension relationship and force velocity relationship. If this discussion was worth watching, then like, share, and subscribe to my channel.